and I share a few things with you. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have. We've had a good time. Always have a good time when we come here, and a lot of sweet fellowship. And you know, we have a lot of good friends that live in Elizabeth and around here. So it's always a joy to be over here. And hope that maybe we've opened your eyes to a few things. As I said when we began, you may not agree with everything we've said this week, and that's okay. But it'll certainly give you something to think about. And hopefully it'll provoke you to deeper study in God's Word. Amen? And so I've also failed to mention this week, I hadn't said a word about it, is our tables back there in the back, but I'm sure all of you have seen it. We have a table back there with some CDs and DVDs and books and things, good study materials. And Miss Sandy has her candle table back there. I know the women have seen the candle table. They usually like to gather around that. Let's see, how did Jesus say that? Something about the way buzzards gather around a carcass or something like that. But I'm just saying that that's what he said about it. Uh-huh. I must not be trying to sell too many candles. Yeah, they smell a lot better. But anyway, we're gonna continue tonight and finish up with the Judgment of Nations will be the last part, the end of chapter 25, Matthew chapters 24 and 25, the Olivet Discourse. And so before we begin, let's have a word of prayer. Father, we want to come before you again tonight to thank you for all your many wonderful blessings. And thank you, Lord, for the good showers that some have enjoyed today. And we thank you for this week, Lord, everything that we've experienced and the joy of being together to read and study your word. It's always a pleasure. And I pray, Father, that our faiths have been strengthened, that we might be better servants for you. Now, Lord, we still have this one last lesson before us. We ask your blessings upon our efforts here tonight. May everything that we say and do bring honor and glory to Jesus. For you know our heart, Lord, you know that's our desire. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, tonight is lesson number 5 in our series, the last lesson. Last night we began by talking about the last half of the tribulation, starting with the abomination of desolation and going all the way to the second coming. The abomination of desolation, you remember, is a particular sin that the Antichrist will commit when he moves in and takes control of Jerusalem and then sits in the temple and claims to be God. That happens right at the middle of the tribulation, and so from there to the end is 3.5 years, and then the Lord will come. We also talked about the second coming of the Lord and how that Matthew recorded that Jesus said that these signs that would lead up to his second coming, we talked about how they would happen all in one generation of people. They would be in one lifetime of people, wouldn't be scattered out over centuries. And then we finished the lesson by looking at some current events to see how things kind of add up or how they relate to those signs that deal with earthquakes. We talked about that one. And also pestilences. And I want to continue with that tonight. Just before we get into that Judgment of Nations study, let's continue with this idea of looking at, we'll look at famines and weather signs and that sort of thing, those signs that we could call the labor pain signs. Well, another one of those, as I said, is the sign of famines. And famines would also be one of those birth pain signs that Jesus mentioned. In our day of modern technology and agricultural productivity, you would think that famines or starvation would be a thing of the past, that everybody in the world would have plenty to eat. But that's just simply not so. I want to share a few articles with you that I've picked up relating to that. This is from the Wikipedia Encyclopedia. It says approximately 40% of the world's agricultural land is seriously degraded. 40%. In Africa, if current trends of soil degradation continue, the continent might be able to feed just 25% of its population by the year 2025, according to the UNU's Ghana-based Institute for Natural Resources in Africa. As of late 2007, increased farming for use in biofuels, along with world oil prices at nearly $100 a barrel, has pushed up the price of grain used to feed poultry and dairy cows and other cattle, causing higher prices of wheat, which is up 58%, soybeans up 32%, and maize up 11% over the year. Food riots have recently taken place in many countries across the world. In fact, I can tell you this, you know, in our American news media, when they're talking about all the uprisings in the countries in the Middle East and North Africa, you know, they try to purport that the motivation behind that, the cause is, you know, the people want to have more of a democratic government and have more say in their government. And they're overthrowing these dictators, basically, like Hosni Mubarak and Egypt, and trying to overthrow Muammar Gaddafi and Libya and so forth. But the truth is, and if you really get into it and study it, that the thing that's really driving these uprisings is that people are starving to death. A lot of these people have the price of just basic food items have gone up so much that they just can't afford to buy food anymore. And it's that drives the unrest. And I also believe that the Muslim Brotherhood, which is a major terrorist organization in Egypt, is kind of behind this. They use that situation and that discontent in the hearts of the people to encourage them to revolt against their governments. Of course, in doing so, I also believe the Muslim Brotherhood will make an attempt to gain control in all of those governments. Right now, Egypt, for instance, is controlled. They have a military. Of course, you know, even when Mubarak was still president, the country was basically controlled by the military. But they have a military council that's controlling the country right now. But they're supposed to have democratic elections. And I read just the other day that at first the Muslim Brotherhood had said that they would not have a candidate running in the presidential election, but they've changed their mind. And now I think they actually have two men who are devout, I guess you could call them Islamists. That is to say, they want to revert the country back to Sharia law, Islamic law. And both of those guys have already stated that if they are elected, the first thing they'll do is cancel the peace treaty that Egypt has with Israel. And so Egypt will go right back to its old ways of being, you know, the terrorist country that it was for so long. This peace treaty that Israel's had with them, they've had it now for about 30 years, but it looks like that's about to crumble. And I think all of this, of course, I'm kind of getting away from the lesson here, but I think all of this is leading up to a kind of caliphate. A caliphate is is an Islamic nation of nations. And I think that you're going to see a lot of those nations like Egypt and Syria and Lebanon and Jordan and Libya and Morocco, Tunisia, those nations kind of joining together and becoming a unified enemy against the nation of Israel, according to what the Bible tells us. I think that's where we're headed. And that's where this, they call this the Arab Spring. You know, these uprisings, they're calling it the Arab Spring. But in my newsletter that I'm writing right now, I call it the Arab Fall, because I think it's going to lead to their fall. And so, these nations in the Arab Spring, I believe, are going to come together to attack Israel. But one of the motivations, one of the things that is driving this is people can't get enough food. And that's part of it. Additionally, the epidemic spread of wheat-killing fungi is presently devastating grain crops. Again, Wikipedia says this: an epidemic of stem rust on wheat caused by race UG99 is currently spreading across Africa, Asia, and most recently into the Middle East, and is causing major concern due to the large numbers of people dependent on wheat for sustenance. The strain was named after the country where it was identified, Uganda, and the year of its discovery in 1999. It spread to Kenya, then Ethiopia, Sudan, and Yemen, and is becoming more virulent as it spreads. Last night, this fungi is spreading and it's killing, you know, huge harvests of wheat, and that's hurting the world's supply of this basic food item is wheat. Notice it says it's becoming more virulent, meaning that it's becoming more difficult to kill this this fungi that's attacking the wheat. And the gentleman, I don't remember his name, but he was here last night. He came up to me afterwards after we talked about the mutating bacteria, you know, and the superbugs that seem to be developing now. And he said, I do a lot of landscaping work. And he said, what we're finding is that weeds are the same way. It's getting harder and harder to find certain poisons that will deal with all of the weeds and, the non-desirable plants. And he said it's like they're changing. He said they're mutating. Well, that lines up right here with the same thing that this thing is saying. So, and then if you add to that the insecurity that the world's food supplies, we have a controversy that's going on these days over the problem of changing our food groups, changing them over from just eating for food, and changing them over to the use in biofuels. Where there's ever increasing demand for energy, and as the hydrocarbon resources get lower and lower, fewer oil deposits and gas deposits, farmers are finding out that they can get more money for their crops by selling them to use them for production and alcohol, for biofuels, rather than using them for food. In order for the United States to meet the biofuel target introduced in the Energy Independence and Security Act, 40% of the land that is currently devoted to corn production would have to be converted to biofuel feedstock production. Now, that's pretty alarming. In other words, our politicians have passed laws that says we've got to, we've got to get away from oil. And one of the ways in doing that is to use, corn and, other crops. I don't know. That's one of those intelligent Longville answers. I don't know. What? Thank you, hon.
It says resume slideshow.
Click it. See what it does. Does it have an X? Exit.
I'm trying to. Hit the X. I'm trying to. It's not.
It won't. Well, we have to start over. Where were we at? Down here?
No.
Okay.
It was on 8.
Okay. But anyway, this statistic says that our government is pushing farmers in that direction by passing laws and encouraging them, to use more of their produce for producing energy rather than producing food, and that's going to create some great food shortages. The World Bank's president Robert Zoellick said this: while many worry about filling their gas tanks, many others around the world are struggling to fill their stomachs. And it's getting more and more difficult every day. Well, let me give you some interesting statistics here about starvation that I found on the website. This is on a website called ThinkQuest. It says that every year, 15 million children die of hunger. Think of that, 15 million children. The World Health Organization estimates that one-third of the world is well-fed, one-third is underfed, and one-third is starving. And there's probably one-third that's overfed, amen? Some of y'all that just came across that street there. Okay. And then every 3.6 seconds, somebody dies from hunger. So in spite of man's advancements in technology and agricultural productivity, the old scourge of starvation is still stalking the earth. It's still a problem. But secular forecasts of the future food supplies and distribution seem to be pretty much evenly divided between positive and negative. Some people say that eventually our technology is going to be able to, you know, feed the world. And others are saying, no, it's our technology that's actually creating the problems of starvation. And so it's difficult to say whether we are really experiencing a rise in starvation, but there seems to be a rise in it anyway when you read about it on the Internet. The Bread for the World website paints a pretty sad picture of our hunger situation and starvation in the world. Here's some statements that, again, that I picked up from that website. It said, the world is facing a hunger crisis unlike anything it has seen in more than 50 years. It said 1.02 billion people are hungry. That's got to be about one sixth. I think there's about, 6 billion people in the world? So that's like one out of six. Every day, almost 16,000 children die from hunger-related causes. That's one child every 5 seconds. There were 1.4 billion people in extreme poverty in 2005. The World Bank estimates that the spike in global food prices in 2008, followed by the global economic recession in 2009 and 2010, has pushed between 100 and 150 million people into poverty. That's why I was saying, you know, when food prices go up here in the United States, it just means that, we have to devote a little bit more of our weekly budget money to buying groceries. But in a lot of places in the world, when food prices go up like that, they just have to do without. They just can't buy food because they don't have the money. And so, of course, we're extremely blessed here in the United States. Amen. Revelation 6 gives an overview of the events that are going to transpire during the tribulation through the symbolism that some people have called the four horsemen of the apocalypse. I'm sure you're familiar with that. And it's a progression of four different horse riders that come on the scene, and this is symbolic, of course, that show the way things will be during the tribulation. The first one is riding a white horse, and he's symbolic of the Antichrist, who the Bible says goes forth conquering and to conquer. And so his conquests bring on the second rider, which is the red horse rider, which is symbolic of bloodshed through warfare. War always produces famine and starvation because farms are destroyed, crops are destroyed in battle, and many of the agricultural assets that are used, you know, for making agricultural equipment is switched over to making weapons. And so there's a shortage of the equipment and so forth that's needed to grow crops. And then the third one that comes on the scene is the black horse rider, which is symbolic of famine and starvation. Along with malnutrition and the destruction of warfare comes the aftermath of disease. After warfare, you have disease and widespread death, symbolized by the fourth horseman that comes on the scene, which is kind of a, they call him the pale horse rider. He's kind of, the Greek word really means a kind of a sickly, a yellowish green color, which is symbolic of death. And his name that sat on him was death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. So this is a kind of an overall description of what the 7 years is going to be like, beginning with the Antichrist who goes forth to conquer the world and eventually ends up in warfare and bloodshed and starvation and disease and just massive, massive death toll. So again, just as with earthquakes, the Bible tells us that the worst famine and starvation that man will ever experience is going to be during the Great Tribulation, just before Jesus returns. It'll be the time of climaxes. It'll be the worst earthquakes, the worst starvation, the worst bloodshed, the worst of the worst of all mankind. And you remember I told you the other night we were talking about, you know, that question sometimes people ask about if a person hears the gospel before the rapture, but refuses it, can he be saved after the rapture during the tribulation? And I said, the first thing I want to ask somebody when they ask that is, why are you asking that? Because many times people want to take that wait-and-see attitude and say, well, I'll just wait and see if the rapture happens, and then if it really is true, then I'll accept Christ. People that have that mindset have no idea just how bad the tribulation is going to be. Like I said before, it's going to be hell on earth. It's going to be the worst thing. There's just no comparison. Jesus said there's no time in all of history that even compares to how bad it's going to be. And so as I said here, with the earthquakes and with the starvation and with the warfare and all these things, it's really going to be the time of climaxes. And even though, you know, some say that, you know, we're getting better able to feed the masses, you know, you always have problems with things like destructive weather that kills the crops, you know. I don't know if this is, I hadn't really been watching it. I don't know if the Midwest, where all of the big grain crops are grown in the United States, are they suffering drought up there like we are down here? If they are, then I'm sure the corn crops and stuff are going to suffer this year. Weather is always a factor. Warfare, politics, all of that is moving us in the direction of what the Bible describes is going to be during the tribulation period. Now, it's difficult to quantify famines statistically and say emphatically that starvation is definitely on the rise. You know, in all of our advances in science, I think one thing that we can say for sure, though, is that famine is not on the decrease. If anything, I believe it really is on the increase. And even with great scientific strides towards, you know, high-yield food production, by the way, I was talking with someone the other night, and we were talking about the changes in the crops, the huge crops, the big crops like corn and soybeans and things like that, that they're using, you know, a lot of hybrid seeds now, and there's some problems with those hybrid seeds. They make huge productions, you know, that's why they do use them. But number one, they don't reproduce. You can't just take those seeds from that crop and replant them the next year. It won't grow. They're sterile plants. And then secondly, I was reading recently that the nutritional value of these hybrid produced plants is much lower. So, you know, you can eat that filler to fill your belly, but you don't really get the nutrition out of it that we always have from, you know, our standard seed, just the, you know, the seeds that God gave us. And so things are definitely changing in the area of agriculture. And with all the programs around the world that try to, you know, equalize food production and distribution so that, you know, the countries that produce the most food can feed the countries where starvation is the worst. And all the efforts to do that, there's one thing that nobody can control, and that's destructive weather. And we've been talking about that because even now we're going through a really seemingly unusual weather pattern for our area, I think. I don't think it's It's normal for us to be this hot and dry at this time of the year. But in addition to earthquakes, Luke says that Jesus also said, great signs shall there be from heaven. Now, the word that's translated heaven actually means the sky. In other words, there are going to be upheaval and disturbances in the atmosphere. There'll be all kinds of storms and floods and droughts. Luke 21:26 says that these cataclysmic events will result in men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Let me ask you something. Back just a few months ago when we were in the midst of this spring tornado blitz that we were in, did it seem unusual to you that we were having so many tornadoes? And did it also seem unusual that they seemed to be striking populated areas? And I just wondered if God wasn't trying to tell us something. There's a guy named Bill Keening. He wrote a book called Eye to Eye, and the whole theme of the book is that if you look through history, every time our government or our president has done anything to try to force Israel into giving up her land, we suddenly have some huge natural disaster in our country. Well, when all these tornadoes were striking, do you remember what President Obama did? He came out with his new Middle East policy speech, and the first thing he said was that Israel needed to return to her pre-1967 borders. In other words, she needed to totally give up Samaria and Judea, the area that we call the West Bank, and give up Gaza, which they already have done that, and to also give up the Golan Heights in the north back to Syria. If Israel were to do that, it would be national suicide. It would give them indefensible borders. There's no way that they could defend themselves with those borders. And, of course, their prime minister, Mr. Benjamin Netanyahu, has said over and over again that they will not do that. They definitely will not do that. But at the same time that, you know, our president's pushing them to do that, lo and behold, we're having a outbreak of tornadoes unlike anything we've seen. So I don't think it's all by accident. I mean, some people can write it off as accident if they want to. You know, back in 2005, whenever we forced Israel, really, their prime minister then was Ariel Sharon, but we pushed him, President Bush pushed him and encouraged him to withdraw from Gaza. And they literally went in there, the Jewish people did, and drug their own people out of Gaza. Those Jewish farmers who had built their homes and their lives there, they were literally drug out of their homes, and they turned all of that over to the Palestinian Arabs. Do you know at the very same time they drew those things out, drew those settlers out, the next day there was a little storm formed out in the Atlantic that became known as Katrina. I mean, you can see it over and over again. Anytime America works against Israel, we always have some major disasters. Well, if you look at the destructiveness of storms, you know, all around the world, which we certainly don't have time to do that, we would want to ask ourselves this question: are there more floods? Are there more droughts and hurricanes and thunderstorms and tornadoes today than in the past? And are the numbers of these disturbances expected to increase in the future? Well, you kind of have to come to your own conclusion. But some scientists claim that the greenhouse gases that we're producing in our world is changing our weather patterns. It's creating what they call global warming. Now, let me just say right up front that Al Gist doesn't believe in global warming. I think the whole thing's a hoax. But I do believe that we're probably making some kind of impact on the atmosphere with all of the pollutants that we're pouring into our atmosphere. Over the years of doing that, the decades and decades of doing that, I think it's bound to have some kind of effect on our weather. I don't know if it's creating global warming, but I do believe it is affecting our weather. According to the Environmental Protection Agency, a major contributing factor to this global warming is the use of fossil fuels, and which is expected to increase. Listen to this quote. Estimates of future emissions and removals depends in part on assumptions about changes in underlying human activities. For example, the demand for fossil fuels such as gasoline and coal is expected to increase greatly with the predicted growth of the U.S. and global economies. Now, all that's saying is that as economies continue to grow, and of course, China is really, you know, booming. They're growing. Their economy is growing in leaps and bounds. And they have practically no kind of safeguards against, hurting the environment. I mean, they just pour their pollutants into the air and don't even care about it. And so the world is definitely changing because of what man is doing. That's all I'm trying to say. Somehow it's affecting even our atmosphere. I read recently, I was doing some research on oil production around the world and oil usage, and I wish I could remember the exact number, but it's something like 1 million barrels of oil per second is used in the world, in the whole world, not just here in the United States. But the biggest use of oil, of course, over one-fourth of the oil that's used in the whole world is here in the United States. We are by far the largest oil consumer. So, you know, I don't know if y'all have ever watched. Sometimes I'm amazed when I go into a big city and I see, you know, 8 lanes of traffic that are bumper to bumper for miles and miles. And I'm thinking about all those exhaust pipes just sitting there pumping out exhaust fumes in the atmosphere. You know, that's got to have some kind of long-term effects. We may not see it very suddenly, but I think, this again is just my opinion, but I think it's affecting our atmosphere, and that in turn affects our weather. Now, that's just my thoughts on that. But a lot of times I've done it this way, and I want to do it here tonight. I've done a little straw poll, and so we're going to take a little poll here tonight, just ask you, does it appear to you that in your lifetime, you know, your own personal witness of it, that destructive weather patterns are increasing, you know, more hurricanes, tornadoes, thunderstorms, all that kind of stuff. Does it seem to you that destructive weather patterns are increasing from the time that you can remember, you know, taking notice of the weather? If you feel like that weather seems to be getting worse with, you know, droughts and floods and all of that sort of thing, if you think it's getting worse in your lifetime, raise your hand. Okay. All right. Thank you. Typically, when I take that question, ask that question, somewhere around 80 to 90% of the people will raise their hand. Now, that's not a scientific poll, but what it tells me, because I do this over and over in different places, what it tells me is that from the perspective of people believe that weather's getting worse. And I don't think that that big of a majority of the people could necessarily be wrong. I think there's got to be something to it. So, is weather getting worse? I think it is, but I don't have any way of proving that. I mean, it's kind of a statistical impossibility, I guess you'd say. I don't know any way to prove that, but I certainly believe, and it appears that weather patterns are getting much worse, destructive, much more destructive. Now, it's difficult to say with statistical certainty that we're experiencing increases in the strength and frequency of all these things, like earthquakes, famines, pestilence, and storms. But one thing I think we can definitely say, and you would probably agree this, those things are definitely not on the decline, are they? I think, if anything, they're getting worse. I mean, even with our advancements in technology and productivity, it seems like man's attempts to solve these problems is just not going to do it. It's actually making things worse. And it's just like, you know, those antibiotics, our use of antibiotics, how that's created, you know, super diseases. We were talking about that. And, of course, the use of biofuels, which is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. is jeopardizing our food sources and creating starvation around the world. And then, of course, all the greenhouse gas emissions is changing our weather patterns and so forth. And so I just don't see it getting any better, is what I'm trying to say. Now, the one area in which human activity is not a contributing factor is in the area of earthquakes. You know, it's just like our planet is reeling under her pains of labor, with the surface of our planet surging and recoiling with increasing consistency. When all of these signs are studied together, I think it makes for a pretty compelling argument that the beginning of these labor pain signs are shouting to us, get ready, the end of the age is near. Because Jesus said that when all these things suddenly increase, that will be a sign that we're nearing the end of the age. He said concerning these things, he said, when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Well, I think certainly we could say that these things are beginning to come to pass. Now let's go back in our study where we left off. We're going to go back over to Matthew 24 again, verse 34. After making his statement that all of these signs would happen in one generation, which we talked about last night, Jesus concludes this part of his dissertation by affirming the trustworthiness of his word. Now, I don't have any problem with that. If he said it, I believe it. But now a lot of people don't. But he said this. He said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. And what he had just revealed to his disciples, he said, was absolutely reliable. It was even more reliable than the existence of the planet itself. Heaven and earth, he said, would pass away, but these things will not pass away. My words are absolutely faithful and true. Well, then he went on to say that even though his followers could be sure about these signs pointing to his second coming, that they would come to pass exactly the way he said that they would, and that these things would tell them when his return was near, even at the doors. Then he makes a remark that makes it perfectly clear, though, that it's impossible for them to know the exact day of his return. Verse 36, he said, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father often. My Father only. Now, let me ask you this. And we've kind of talked about this a little bit already, but how often has this scripture been quoted to try to say that nobody knows when the rapture is going to happen? Well, I mean, I've heard it a gazillion times, right? Is that what he's talking about? Is he talking about the rapture? Not at all. I mean, everything we've talked about up to this point has been in answer to the question that his disciples asked him. And they said, you know, when are you going to return? And what's the sign of the, you know, of your coming again? When is the end of the world, the end of the age going to happen? He's talking about the second coming. And Jesus said concerning the second coming that no one would know when that's going to happen. Well, this brings up a kind of an interesting dilemma because, you know, in Daniel 9:27, it tells us that the abomination of desolation is going to happen when? Right in the middle of the 7 years. So, the 7 years are 7 years of 360 days each. So, if you look at the screen here, if we have 7 years of 360 days, that's 2,520 days. If we divide that right in the middle, that means the abomination and desolation will happen 1,260 days after it begins and 1,260 days before the end of the tribulation. You see that? Well, if you know that and you're living in the tribulation, couldn't you see the abomination of desolation take place and say, well, the end of the tribulation is 1,260 days from now? You could calculate it, right? Well, that's only true if the second coming happens exactly on the last day of the tribulation. right? The point I'd like to make is that I don't believe that his second coming will happen on the last day of the tribulation. Now, this may come to a surprise to a lot of people, but it's really not that hard of an idea to accept, because quite often God's prophetic word will tell us about things that will happen, you know, events that are going to take place in the end. And what we tend to do is that we kind of push those events together bumper to bumper, that they're going to come, you know, one right behind the other. But it doesn't always happen that way. Sometimes there are breaks of time in between those events. For example, if you lived in Daniel's day, you know, and God told Daniel that he was going to deal with the Jews for another 490 years, we would probably think it was going to be 490 successive years, one through number 490. But, of course, from our perspective now, we can look back and see that that's not what God meant at all. In fact, what God said was, and we'll look at it again on our chart here, is that from the time the decree was given to rebuild Jerusalem, that would start the 490 years, and the first 483 years would end at the crucifixion. And then we would enter into a special break time, I guess you'd call it, the church age, which nobody knows how long that's going to be. But after that was over, then the church, I mean, the world would go into the last 7 years of the 490 years. The 483 plus the 7 is the 493 years. So we would have thought that the whole 490 years would have been successive, not realizing that there was going to be like a 2,000-year break in there called the church age. You see, many times God puts breaks in between these things, and we need to recognize that. So we might ask, will the tribulation actually start immediately after the rapture? I said this the other night, but some people believe that the rapture is what actually starts the tribulation. But that's not true. The event that marks the beginning of the tribulation is what? The confirming of the covenant. Yeah, the treaty that the Antichrist will sign with Israel. Now, we assume that that covenant is a peace agreement. It probably will be. It'll guarantee Israel to, you know, the right to exist within secure borders. But the very moment that they sign that document, the 7 years start. That's the beginning of the 7 year tribulation. So it's not the rapture that starts the tribulation. It's the signing of the covenant with Israel. And do you think that that signing of the covenant will happen exactly on the same day as the rapture? Well, I don't think it will. Probably won't. You see, Daniel 7:8 tells us that the Antichrist is going to rise to power by subduing 3 of 10 kings. There's going to be some kind of 10-man executive board that's ruling over the last day's empire, European empire, what we call the revived Roman Empire. There will be 10 men, and the Bible indicates that the Antichrist is going to come to power in the midst of that 10-king unit, and that he will eventually become the supreme leader of all 10 kings. When you get over to Revelation chapter 17, it says, you know, that all 10 kings are still around, and they are subordinates to Mr. Antichrist. And so he's going to come to power that way. Also, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, it tells us that he will be revealed, that is to say, he'll make his rise to power before the tribulation begins. And so obviously the Antichrist will have to be in power for some period of time. He'll have to be established as that world leader before he'll be in a position to negotiate this peace treaty with Israel. And even though we don't know this for sure, it's very likely, I think, that his rise to power will come after the rapture. Why do you say that? Well, listen, the rapture is going to create chaos around the world. I mean, you think about it. Suddenly, millions of people disappear from the planet. And I'm telling you, it's going to create chaos, especially here in the United States, because I think a bigger percentage of people who are true Christians are here in the United States. In fact, I think that it will, if the United States is still a leading world power at that time, I think it'll reduce this country to third world status. I mean, it'll be that devastating. And so there's going to be anarchy and chaos right after the rapture. And the world is going to be looking for someone who can bring back peace and order and prosperity to the planet. Up steps Mr. Antichrist, and he's the guy with all the answers. And the Bible says that he will be extremely eloquent, very persuasive with his speech. He'll be better than Bill Clinton. I mean, he's going to be able to convince people that he is the answer. And so I believe that that will be the time of his rise to power, and that that will occur after the rapture, but before the tribulation begins. I simply say all of that to simply say that, you know, that there's going to be a short space of time. The church is going to be raptured, and then there'll be a short space, probably not more than a few months, but a short space of time where the Antichrist comes to power and he gets to the point where he can negotiate that treaty with Israel, and then finally they sign it. And so that starts the tribulation period. It's what we might call a pre-tribulation preparation time. It's a time where things are being set up, so to speak, to start the tribulation period. Well, if the signing of the covenant with Israel marks the beginning of the tribulation, what is it that marks the end of the tribulation? The Bible says that there's a series of judgments that will be poured out by God on the planet. And the last seven of those, we call them bowl judgments. The King James uses the word vile, but we would call them bowl judgments that are poured out upon the earth. And when that last one, the seventh bowl judgment, is poured out by this angel, the Bible says in Revelation 16:17 that he says, "It is done," meaning it's finished. This concludes the tribulation period. And then according to Matthew 24:29, that's when this great upheaval takes place. You remember where it said immediately after the tribulation of those days, and then it says, and then after the cosmic upheaval shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then after that shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Now, that word then, you know, is quite interesting. It could mean at the same time as, or it can mean subsequent to.